a little bit of preview. I was telling you that there is a whole class of spacetimes in which the kinematic structure is such that you have one coordinate system and a hyperbolic trajectory for an observer, and this observer perceives a horizon. And I gave you examples like the short sail, then de-Sitter, and then I came back to Rindler flat spacetime. Now we are going to discuss Rindler to begin with, and it will turn out that because of the similarity of the structure, what we are going to say in Rindler is applicable in a much broader generality. And in fact, Rindler is applicable to any spacetime in some sense. But if you look at these three dynamically, of course, these two are curved spacetimes. There is a non-zero curvature and there is some material source, in particular if you take black hole spacetime. And if I tell you that there is an observer who is sitting quietly at a distance r, in general relativity, if you are staying put in a particular point, you are accelerating. And if you are falling towards the earth, you are not accelerating. That is the way you think of it in general relativity. Normal human beings would have said that if you drop a body, it is accelerating towards the earth, while if it is staying put, it is not accelerating. But in general relativity, in the freely falling frame, there is no acceleration. But if it is sitting quietly on a table, it is accelerating because it is not in freely falling frame. So this r is equal to constant line of an observer is an accelerated trajectory. And that is the trajectory which perceives this horizon. And then if I say that there is some weird property of the horizon, it has entropy, it has temperature, you will say, oh yeah, fine, interesting, but nothing very surprising. Same thing will happen for this. But then I will tell you that in flat space-time, if there is an observer who is accelerating, he will attribute to it a temperature and entropy. For some reason, people find it strange. So part of the exercise in these lectures is to sort of make this strangeness go away and make you understand that this is all the two sides of the same coin, so to speak. The thing to watch out there is this particular functional dependence I have written down. So in this case, there is some function, reciprocal of that function, reciprocal of that function, same thing here. And this horizon always corresponds to this quantity being equal to zero. So in the short sail, for example, everybody knows that RS, when the short sail radius is equal to 2m, that is the horizon. And when in de-Sitter, it happens to be the Hubble radius, 1 upon h. And here it is set by the acceleration of the observer. There is also one more peculiar thing you should take note of here. We will, all these we are going to revisit. This is like a preview to orient yourself. If you look at short sail, for example, I have put minus here and plus here. And notice that this lecture on the signature has flipped. It is minus for the time and plus, plus, plus for the space, because I have to do analytic continuation very frequently. When t goes to it, I would like to get a positive definite metric. Here there is a minus sign, and as long as you are at an r greater than 2m, that is you are outside the horizon, which is what normal observers in a black hole spacetime would be situated, then this t is time and r is space. But if r is less than 2m, that is if you are in some region here, then the sign of these two flip. So even though I have called it t, it is not a time coordinate, it is like a space coordinate, and this is a time coordinate. And because metric depends on rs, you can no longer say it is time independent. Okay? This is something very peculiar. Again, when I present it in the context of either black hole or even in the cosmology in a curved space-time, you'll say, oh, it is one of those things which happens in GR. But it happens in flat space-time. In flat space-time, here is a time coordinate, and this is XR, and this X goes all the way from minus infinity to plus infinity, and the horizon is located at X is equal to 0, just like in all other cases. Where this function vanishes, you have the horizon. So even the X is negative, this is not a time coordinate. It becomes like a spatial coordinate, and this becomes like a time coordinate. But after all, this is flat space-time, so there is nothing funny going on. What is going on is that as far as this particular observer in this trajectory is concerned, the space-time mimics as though there is a switch. If you take some other observer, it is not going to happen. What is the analog in black hole space-time? In the black hole space-time, if you take an observer who is plunging into the black hole, the kind of thermodynamics he will attribute to the black hole are very different. So this is again a universal feature, but in the black hole or a de Sitter space-time, it is easy to accept, but not in flat space-time. That is why I am going to concentrate much more on Rindler space-time than on black hole space-time. We will discuss all of them, but this is what I will concentrate. Okay. Then I started by saying why these horizons are hot, and we have already done it. We showed that there is this thermal density matrix which can be obtained from the Euclidean kernel in quantum mechanics, where you start at Q and go back to Q in a time interval, imaginary time interval equal to beta. So this IT you put equal to beta. And then in some loose sense, as I said, this comes from a very rigorous theory behind the blackboard. It is called the KMS condition, etc. But naively speaking, the IT and beta has a correspondence. And if the imaginary time is periodic with some period beta, then the inverse of that period will give you the temperature. This is what is going to happen. So the spacetimes in the horizons does exhibit periodicity in the imaginary time. And in particular, Rindler spacetime does that. So I want to illustrate that next. In order to do that, let us take a sheet of paper. So this is a sheet of paper, and it has this Cartesian coordinates y and x, and then there are polar coordinates theta and r. And the transformation between them is x is r cos theta and y is r sin theta. These are r is equal to constant lines, and these are theta equals constant line. And the metric is dy square plus dx square, it becomes r square d theta square like that. Next, just for fun, I am going to introduce a g here because eventually I want to scale it with that g. So once I have got that, I now think of the same xy plane in terms of the Euclidean time in the Minkowski space and x. Okay? So this is what we discussed yesterday. You are in flat space time, in fact, two dimensional flat space time here. The other dimension, just go for a ride, two dimensional flat space time. And we are going to analytically continue from real time to imaginary time. This is the analytically continued time, and this is the Euclidean two dimensional flat space. And in the Euclidean two dimensional flat space, I can use Cartesian coordinates, but I can also use polar coordinates. Until yesterday, we just used Cartesian coordinates, and we analytically continued back and forth from TE to IT and back and forth. Now I am going to introduce a polar coordinates, and I am going to call this as G times tau E. It could be just tau E, but G is convenient because that is what the acceleration is going to finally give you. And I say that this whole thing is going to be equal to 2 pi, that is G times tau E is between 0 and 2 pi, and you have this. So again, this is just x is equal to r cos theta, t is equal to r sin theta, and it covers this whole space. These coordinates are perfectly good coordinates, and these coordinates cover exactly the same manifold as the Cartesian coordinates cover. There is nothing wrong in using polar coordinates in a sheet of paper. And this is what the metric is. What I will now do is to analytically continue back from this Cartesian Euclidean coordinates to Cartesian Minkowski coordinates. So I am going to take this TE to IT and also simultaneously change the polar Euclidean coordinates, and hopefully I will get some polar Minkowskian coordinates. I have to see what I get. So I can analytically continue either in this TE or in tau E. So I have written those equations down and see what happens. What happens is that your cos and sine is going to become cos h and sin h here. That is the main difference. Okay? The I factors will take care of themselves. What was x square plus t square equals some constant, that circle, is going to become x square minus t square equals something, and that is a hyperbola. This is the hyperbola which we keep hearing, seeing in all those cases like de Sitter, short sail, etc. And then there is a tau equals constant and r equals constant. And what happens to the metric? The metric is minus dt square plus dx square, no surprises. But here you get a metric which is minus gr square plus this. It is just that dta going into dt. Okay? So you have got this metric. But then if I put a guy in this R is equal to constant, he is going to have a horizon and this region is not accessibility. So this is my Minkowski spacetime, and in that Minkowski spacetime I have introduced two new coordinates R and tau by this transformation. But I can already see that this transformation, after all cos h square is always greater than sin h square, only covers this particular wedge. I draw this 45 degree lines and only this wedge is covered. So if I start from this Euclidean plane where everything is fine and honky-dory, and this covers the entire Euclidean plane, in particular this covers negative values of x. The moment I make this transformation, this x is positive definite. So if I want to cover negative x, I have to do something else, and we will come back much later what to do. But there is essentially this one wedge. Now, of course, if you are thinking of an observer who is sitting outside the black hole and he wants to have a coordinate system, then this is good enough. Similarly, if you have an accelerated observer, he can use that. We will show how for an accelerated observer this emerges naturally. So this is what happens here. But if some, so this is just to emphasize this point, but if you just look at, let me go back to this. If somebody has given you this metric, there are two things which you can divine out of that. First is that here the metric is independent of t, all the coefficients are trivially independent of t, it is static. But it is also independent of tau, right? So everything is static to this observer as well. So what you can do with t, to some extent you can do with tau, that is the first point to note. Second point is that once you have this kind of a coordinate transformation, if you had started with these coordinates, suppose somebody has just given you a metric with this coordinate, then if you are clever enough to find these transformations, you will end up getting this coordinate system. So in this coordinate system, I would have said that tau goes from minus infinity to plus infinity and r goes from 0 to infinity. When I extend this in this form, I again say the same thing. But now I suddenly find that the manifold seems to have opened up. This is called analytic extension of a manifold. The original coordinate chart covered only part of the manifold, and I discover new regions which I did not have before. Again here, this is the distinction between flat spacetime and curved spacetime. If I give you this metric and say that this transformation takes you here, you won't bat an eyelid. You say, yeah, that's fine, you know, it is only covering part of it. But this is exactly what is going to happen in black hole spacetime. In black hole spacetime, when you do this, one singularity will become two singularities, and there will be a white hole region, and there will be two exteriors, etc. It's a whole mess. But the mathematics involved in it is exactly same as this. The manifold in which you have used a coordinate chart, that chart covers only part of the manifold. And you have to do, there is a constructive method of finding out whether a chart covers only part of the manifold or the full manifold. This is part of differential geometry and GR, which we won't go into, but by which you can figure out what is the full manifold, okay? So this is a simple example of a manifold in which you have used a coordinate chart, and with a suitable coordinate transformation, you can discover the full manifold. Okay, now let us proceed further. So the first thing I want to teach you is something called Bogolyubov transformation, and this is a contribution from a Russian scientist, Bogolyubov, and this actually came up in condensed matter physics, that is where it is extensively used, but we guys borrowed it and we are using it in quantum field theory in curved spacetime. Now what Bogolyubov transformation does is to define new particles from old, so to speak. So I will give you one example in a familiar context. In condensed matter, if I have a lattice and electrons and or even just lattice, the lattice vibrations are quantized in terms of something called phonons. So the phonons can be thought of as a field, just like our scalar field. And these phonons can have creation and annihilation operators. It can have a momentum. And I can have an operator which creates a phonon of a given momentum, and it destroys a phonon of a given momentum. And then I can write down the Hamiltonian. I can study interactions between phonons and electrons, etc., etc. In some more complicated context, like in superconductivity, you might have heard of this thing called Cooper pairs. So this is a particular pairing of the electron. And you can think of a Cooper pair itself as some kind of a particle. You can have a creation and annihilation operator for these pairs. So what you are doing is that you are changing the underlying structure Like after all, the electrons and the lattice is made of some quantum fields. Electrons are excitations of a Dirac field. And the lattice probably is the excitations of a much more complicated spanorial field, because these are all elementary particle excitation. But then when it comes to phonons, you forget that, you take that as a base level, and you are studying excitations above that. So these kind of excitations can be thought of in terms of Bogolyubov transformation. That is why it is very useful in condensed matter. I want to illustrate it in a very simplified watered down context. So to do that, let us go back to our original scalar field we wrote down yesterday. This is nice Lorentz covariant scalar field. This is the invariant volume integral in momentum space. This is the creation operator. This is the annihilation of, sorry, this is the annihilation operator and this is the creation operator. Now I am studying a real scalar field, so I have identified these two. So it is something plus its Hermitian conjugate. So this field is Hermitian. Okay. Now suppose I make a linear transformation. Instead of this AP, I decide to write this AK as some alpha times some BK plus beta times BK dagger. So if I put a dagger on it, I get alpha star and BK dagger plus beta star BK. Alpha and beta are two complex constants, which satisfy the following condition. This condition is imposed so that if you take the commutator of AK and AK dagger, you know that it gives you unity for K. AK and AP dagger will give you a Kronecker delta or Dirac delta on K minus P. If this condition is imposed, you can easily verify that the B will also satisfy the same condition. So this B and B dagger are as good creation and annihilation operator as A and A dagger. So A and A dagger defines for me a vacuum state. And it defines for me one particle excitation, two particle excitation, etc. There is a particle definition in terms of A dagger A, particle number operator. I can also define particle number operator with respect to B dagger B. Now the question is, are these two particles equivalent? It's fairly elementary to see they are not. Because first of all, if you plug this in, that is if you write this quantity there, and then there is a e to the minus ipx, and when you put here, there is a complex conjugate which will kick in. Therefore, you can now write this this same scalar field in terms of B and B dagger with two functions. And these functions are now going to be, this function itself is going to be a linear superposition of e to the minus ikx and e to the plus ikx. Originally, this function here was just made out of positive frequency. Okay, I think I have switched the signature here. Let us think of it as positive frequency. So this is Px taken from the previous slide, so there is a signature switch. So this is omega t minus k dot x, so that is a positive frequency mode and this is the negative frequency mode. And when you plug this in, you are going to get this combination. And these two things are mixed up. Once you have done that, you can also calculate what is, you take the vacuum based on B and B dagger. Then in the B vacuum, you compute how many A particles are there. That is easy because I have a linear relation between A and B. And if you go and put this A and A dagger, when A dagger is sitting in the vacuum state, then you know that only one of them is going to contribute. You can trivially compute that. And the cross term beta, mode beta square, will count the number of particles, number of A type particles in the B type vacuum. So what you thought was a vacuum is no longer a vacuum when you make a Bogolyubov transformation. So what is your particle? Suppose this scalar field has a quantum. Should it be defined with respect to A or should I define it with respect to B? Because both of them, A satisfies some commutators, B also satisfies the same commutators, and I have thrown in an alpha and beta. At that stage, you come up and give an extra criterion. You say that I have to define my particles based on positive frequency. That is, I want these modes to be strictly positive frequency with respect to my time coordinate. You put in as an extra postulate in normal Lorentzian field theory. You say that these should be e to the minus I omega t, which is what you call the positive frequency modes. Once you have got that, you say fk is not allowed because fk is a linear superposition of positive and negative frequencies. And in general, these coefficients alpha and beta are called Bogolyubov coefficients. These are the ones which mix positive, in general, it mixes positive and negative frequencies. You can write down a more general relation. You can take a AK and a BK which can be related to AM in terms of a matrix alpha and beta. Instead of connecting one to one, it can take a wave vector k and map it to another wave vector p. Okay, then it will become a matrix. That will be a more complicated situation. If they are continuum, there are integrals involved, etc. But this is the simplest context. So you need an extra postulate to define what is your particle. And in normal flat space time field theory, in which Lorentz transformation is the only invariance you want to maintain, then you can use this criterion that I want positive frequency modes to be chosen in front of these objects. That uniquely specifies a Lorentz invariant vacuum, and you can convince yourself easily that positive frequency remains positive frequency when you make a Lorentz transformation, so there are no problems. But this doesn't happen in two cases. First, you can't do it in curved space time because you are allowed arbitrary coordinate transformation. If I had some time coordinate and I change t to log t, okay, then if I had a e to the minus I omega t mode, that is going to look like e to the minus I omega log tau mode, where tau is the new time coordinate. That will be a superposition of e to the minus I omega tau and e to the plus I omega tau. That way, a positive frequency mode will become a superposition of positive and negative frequency. So the tau type particles and t type particles will be different. So if you are allowed to make coordinate transformation, then you lose this invariant significance for particles. So the definition of particle itself in a curved space time is very problematic unless you have some other extra symmetry to go by. Now you might say that if there is a nice time coordinate, then I can use that time coordinate and define positive frequency with respect to it. That is true. Now a generally covariant way of talking about this, for those of you who know general relativity, is that there is something called time-like Killing vector field. So a Killing vector field allows you, Killing vector field is just a vector field such that if you go from xi to xi plus, that is ii, nothing changes, the geometry does not change, that vector field has to satisfy a particular differential equation. In an arbitrary manifold, there may not be any Killing vector fields. But in many of the manifolds in which we can do any computation, there will at least be one Killing vector field. And that Killing vector field, if it is time-like in a region, then you have the integral curve of that vector field will define a time coordinate. If you are not familiar with GR, ignore these statements, it is not so important, we will come back to it. So you have a time coordinate. The problem arises when you have more than one time-like Killing vector field in some region. Then I can use positive frequency with respect to either of them. This is exactly what happens. That's correct. Therefore, beta should be 0. Mod alpha square plus minus beta square tells you mod alpha is, you can have a phase, but other than that, nothing.
Also, in the last equation, I have beta square equal to 0.
Absolutely. Exactly. That is what happens in Lorentz. Good. Yeah, that is a neat way of summarizing it. Okay. So what I have been saying, again, I have tried to summarize, the particle definition requires identification of what is a positive frequency mode. Now, this choice is not unique when general coordinate transformation is allowed, and I am giving you the simple example here, which we have done before. So you take x is equal to rho cos h and t is equal to rho sin h, okay, which is a Rindler transformation in just one wedge of the space-time, then this metric is going to go into this. Clearly, movement along t changes nothing. So t is a time-like Killing vector field. That is, if I have a vector field which is pointing in t direction, it is a time-like Killing vector field. If I move along tau also, nothing changes. So if I move along tau also, there is an invariant, tau is another Killing vector field. So I can write down my wave equation and get modes which are either e to the minus I omega t, or I can have modes which is e to the minus I nu tau. And because t and tau are related in this complicated way, the positive frequency with respect to one will not be positive frequency with respect to the other. So the vacuum in one will not be a vacuum in the other, and you will see particles. This is the crux of how the inertial vacuum appears to be filled by particles in another frame. That doesn't tell you why it is filled with a thermal spectrum of particles. In order to see the thermal spectrum of particles, you look at this. And you say tau goes to I tau, if I do, then this becomes plus, And then this d rho square plus rho square delta square is periodic in tau. Okay? If it is not periodic, it will produce a conical singularity at the origin. What do I mean by that? If I take a wedge of a circle, the sector of a circle, and I identify these two, and you make a cone, you know, the sort of thing which you make to put things inside. So you identify these two and you make a cone, so you get something like this. So this has been, this end has been mapped with this end. Then something funny is going on here. There is curvature there, right? It is not flat anyway. But if I am allowed this whole 0 to 2 pi, then there is no curvature, it remains flat. So if I have this kind of a metric with a plus sign here, and I say that g tau should be like theta, but if I say theta doesn't go all the way from 0 to 2 pi, but it goes to 0 to say 2 pi minus epsilon, it is like this kind of a wedge with this being epsilon. It's not small, but it's going to be like this. In which case there is a singularity at the origin, that if, since it is a flat space time, you don't allow that singularity, which means that there has to be a periodicity. Of course, in our transformation, it is obvious, because if I put tau is equal to I tau, these two are periodic. Okay, so in this particular case, it is very simple. But in general, if you just see this metric, you can guess from that it should be periodic. Yes? This is far from a Lorentz transformation. That is correct. That is. It's still flat space time. It's an arbitrary curvilinear coordinate system. Lorentz transformations are fine, because there vacuum remains vacuum, particles remain particle, there are no problems. Okay? This is far from a Lorentz transformation. But it is no more complicated than going from Cartesian coordinates to polar coordinates in a piece of paper. Paper remains a flat space time, and I am just making that transformation. Okay. So that is why it is thermal. The reason it has particles is because there is another time coordinate coming up here, and the reason it is thermal is because it is periodic in tau. So actually I have got you Rindler thermal this thing in two steps, but now we will explore it in much greater detail. For example, this particular way of taking the mode functions, that is, this is called mode function, e to the minus I omega t and e to the minus I omega tau, I am personally never very comfortable, because it clearly breaks the concept of general covariance. So it is very clear that if you have broken the general concept of general covariance, then one observer sees and another observer sees can be different, etc. But at the same time, this phenomena should have a deeper significance. So there must be a way of sort of looking at it as much as possible, maintaining general covariance and then picking it out at the right place. And you should know exactly where you are breaking it. So there are derivations of this which I will give, in which that is very obvious and it is clear. Okay, so we will come to that. Now, why is it that the metric doesn't change when I change tau? What the heck is this tau? Now, actually, it has a physical meaning, which can be derived very formally, etc., but I will try to give you an intuitive picture again here. See, here, if I change tau to tau plus epsilon, what am I doing? I'm going around this circle, right? So this is like a rotation. So this is a rotation by an imaginary angle when I come back to the other frame. Now, some of you might have studied that Lorentz transformations can be thought of, not very rigorously, but for some purposes, as rotation by an imaginary angle. So this, the fact that you have invariance in tau is actually comes from the fact that your original flat space-time is Lorentz invariant. And it has a Lorentz boost vector. That is, I can take the Lorentz frame and look at all the symmetries. It has 10 Killing vectors, and I mean, let us forget complicated terms like Killing vectors. Essentially, we know that the flat spacetime has Lorentz invariance, which means if I boost in a particular direction, that transformation will correspond to a symmetry, and that symmetry corresponds to a particular vector where x mu goes to x mu plus that vector v mu, the everything remains invariant, and that vector's integral curves will have this tau. So this hyperbolic trajectory which you are drawing is essentially the integral curve of the boost Killing vector. So the Lorentz transformations in that is what is masquerading as this Rindler time translation. There is another way to see this which is also interesting. We will come back to that. Look at this. Here the time coordinate is a line like this. tau is equal to constant is this. Now suppose you change tau to tau plus epsilon. In the other case, it was a rotation in a circle. Here, when you go tau to tau plus epsilon, you start with the tau equals 0, and suppose you go to another tau, and this is another plane. And this, I'm sure you have done in special relativity, that a slanted line like this is just the time coordinate of another observer. So a boosted observer will have x is equal to some particular value along this, and this is his time coordinate. Okay? So going from this plane to this plane can be achieved by a Lorentz boost. So the translation along tau is equivalent to Lorentz boost. Because physics is invariant in Lorentz boost, that is exactly what kicks in and gives you another coordinate here, which is the tau coordinate, along with this, there is a invariant. So at this stage, I can do all of what I want to do by starting with these transformations and saying, you know, what is going to happen. But I want to do it in a slightly different way. I wanted to give you a motivation as to where this transformation actually comes from. Because we kept saying accelerated observer, accelerated observer. So what has this to do with accelerated observer? You don't see any acceleration there. Just because you call something g doesn't mean it is an acceleration. So where does that come from? So I want to spend some time describing that. To do that, we want to go back to general relativity or even curvilinear coordinates in flat space-time and ask the question, how does a guy who is moving along some arbitrary trajectory in space-time, it could in principle be just a straight line, which means that he is going with uniform velocity, or it could be some crazy trajectory like this, how does he choose a proper coordinate system? Now, you have to define what a proper coordinate system is, because the moment you allow arbitrary coordinates, you can of course choose any coordinate system you like, and physics will take care of itself. But there are some coordinate systems which are more natural. Rather than saying proper coordinate system, I would prefer to call it a natural coordinate system. And one way of defining the natural coordinate system is by using what is known as radar coordinates, which was introduced by Bondi into general relativity. And I will try to illustrate to you in a very simple context, which is just 1 plus 1. So take 1 plus 1. And this is a guy who is moving in this trajectory. And he has a particular coordinate system. And he wants to attribute a particular coordinate, this is capital X and capital T. And then he is going to attribute a particular coordinate small t and small x with this event. So the question is, how can he do that? So with a lot of insight, he has filled the entire space with mirrors. And at this point, he sends a light ray to this and then get it reflected back. So all that he knows along this trajectory is what is the time in his proper clock. These are the coordinate times here, xa, ta, and xa. And this is tb and xp where he is receiving it back. But he knows at what time these things happen. And using that, he is going to give coordinates for this. So what is the natural way to assign these coordinates? So you start by defining that the trajectory of the observer is given by two parameterized functions, where tau is the proper time shown in his clock. So this is f0 of tau and f1 of tau. So that defines for you the trajectory. Then he will say that the time coordinate to the event p can be taken to be half of ta plus tb. And the spatial coordinate can be taken of half of tb minus ta. Since I don't want to keep going back and forth, and just to maintain the notational consistency, let me just draw it here. So there is a point here to which a signal is sent and it is reflected back. And what I am saying is that this is some TA and this is some TB at which it is received. And then I am going to give coordinates to this, which I will call T prime and X prime. Okay? What is said is that it is reasonable to take T prime to be half of this and X prime to be TB minus TA. Why is it reasonable? Assume that this guy is not moving, he is just staying quietly like this. Then, when he sends a beam and gets it back, it took half the time to go there and half the time to come back. So the time where it hit the mirror is half of the arrival and departure time. So that sounds reasonable, at least in that case. So we just generalize it to any other case. Second, the light has been traveling in flight for a total time interval TB minus TA. And you imagine a C here if you want to. It is C times that time interval is the total distance light has traveled. So, if he was at rest with respect to that point, it would have traveled half that way and half this way. So, the distance to the point, I am taking it to be half. This is just a conventional definition. I am just arguing that it is natural and useful when the guy is going in a, if he is not moving at all. And we will see how reasonable it is by checking one more level where he is moving with a uniform velocity that will calibrate this principle and then use it for other things. You could have given a much more different, you could have said this should be log of this and this should be exponential of this. That is fine. That is the freedom of general coordinate transformation. But this is a simple, relatively easy to understand way of attributing coordinates to events in space-time, and this is what Bondi introduced. Now, rest of it is straight algebra. So, because these are all 45 degree lines, x minus xa is t minus ta and x minus xb is t minus tb, and you can also work out that ta is t prime minus x prime, tb is t prime plus x prime. Then you go and solve it, okay. So, t prime x prime, just yeah, t prime and x prime are the coordinates which this observer is going to use. T and x are the coordinates of the base plane in which this guy is moving. Okay, right. So you have x minus t will come out to be this function. Evaluated at t prime minus x prime, this is not multiplication, it is a function evaluated at that point, minus f prime at this point. Similarly, x plus t will come out, this is just algebra, you just add and subtract these relations and you get that. So, from this, you can write this slightly more neatly if you introduce what is known as retarded and advanced coordinates. So, you introduce a coordinate t minus x which is u and v which is t plus x. So, then the u will be f naught of u prime minus f 1 of u prime and similarly for v. So, there is sometimes I use an alternate notation later on in the talk where instead of calling them f naught and f 1, I will call it f and h. So, I just mentioned it here in case you suddenly see an f and h, okay. So, that is basically it. Now, let us use it. So, I want to take an observer who is moving along with a uniform velocity. So, what is the trajectory? If a guy is moving with uniform velocity, then his proper time is going to be given by this, there is a relationship between the coordinate time and the proper time. This is f1 and this is f0, and the f0, this, remember that the f0 is just a time coordinate. Remember, let me just show it to you once again, maybe I am going too fast. F0 is the time coordinate in the baseline and the f1 is the space coordinate in the baseline. So, the f0 here is related to his proper time by tau by this quantity. This is just time dilation. This quantity into root 1 minus v square is tau. So, the trajectory can be written and similarly for x because that is the v times this quantity. So, because he is traveling with a uniform velocity v, so x is vt, that is all we are saying. So, this quantity f0 multiplied by v, which is v here, will give you f1, x is vt, okay. But I want to rewrite it in terms of the proper time. So, you get a gamma tau here and gamma v tau here. So, I got f1 and f0. Now, you go and ask what should be the coordinates you would have attributed to this. So, what it tells you is that I have written it together. So, just think of just positive if you want to. X plus t will be f1 of t prime plus x prime plus f0 of t prime plus x prime, okay, and with a plus or minus time here. So, you go and plug these back. So, you have the f1 which is gamma v tau. So, that is going to give you, you want to evaluate it at t prime plus x prime. So, you keep the gamma outside and your this tau is replaced by this t prime plus x prime. So, it is v t prime plus v x prime. Here it is, if this quantity is just going to be proportional to tau, this gamma has been taken out, it is t prime plus or minus x prime. So, you look at what this happened, there is a v here, let us pull that v out, then what you have got is the same here, so that comes out here, then you get an 1 plus v divided by gamma, gamma is 1 over square root of this, so that you write as 1 minus v into 1 plus v, so one of the 1 plus v's hang around and the other one will come. So, you get a transformation which tells you that x plus or minus t is x prime plus or minus t prime multiplied by a factor which depends on v. So, now you can solve for x and t separately. If you do that, you will find that t is this and x is this, which is just Lorentz transformation. So, the reason I did it like this, okay, first of all, in special relativity, Lorentz transformations are derived in some horrible ways. It used to be derived in horrible ways when I studied MSc, and I don't think things have changed much. So, this is a nice way of thinking about Lorentz transformation, and it generalizes to any observer. So, you take an arbitrary observer, use light rays and invariant speed of light of the light rays to attribute coordinates to another point, and as coordinates, the radar coordinates of Bondi happens to be the coordinates you would have given if you use just the Lorentz transformation. So, we are just calibrating our idea against things which we know. Of course, for uniform velocity observer who is going there, that is how we defined it. Then, sorry, for an observer who is not moving is where we defined it. For a uniform uniformly moving velocity observer, we would like to get back Lorentz transformation, which we do. Armed with these two, we will take a uniformly accelerated observer. So, we want to know what is the coordinates good for him. So, the coordinates good for him, first you want to know what is the trajectory of a uniformly accelerated observer is. So, that means the rate of change of momentum of a particle should be constant. That is the relativistic definition, and you cancel out the mass to get just the acceleration. So, this is the relativistic acceleration, and you are saying it is equal to some constant, say kappa. So, you can integrate this, because this side is independent of t, you just go and integrate, you will get a kappa t, and then v is dx by dt, and you just go and do the integrals. If you do that, you will find that the coordinate transformations are exactly what we have written down there. But this is, remember, we are now talking about a trajectory. We are not talking about a coordinate frame change. So, this is just the trajectory of an observer, that is capital T and capital X, expressed in terms of tau, which is his proper time. So, these are our functions F naught and F 1, okay. We still haven't found the coordinate system of the accelerated observer. This is the trajectory which an accelerated observer is going to follow. So, to find a coordinate system, you go back and do exactly what we did there. So, your x minus t should be the function which is obtained by adding and subtracting these two. So, if you add and subtract sin h and cos h, you are going to get exponentials. So, you will find x minus t is exponential of kappa times t minus x, and x plus t is exponential of kappa times t plus x. This is no more conceptually different than what we did here. So, you do that, and once you do that, you get these x minus t and x plus t, then you solve back 2x and 2t by adding and subtracting, and you find that the coordinate transformations are given by this. So, you have x, which is cos h of kappa t, and t, which is something sin h of kappa t. This is a coordinate transformation from capital X capital T inertial frame to a coordinate system attributed by an accelerated observer with an acceleration kappa to various events in space time, and those coordinates are denoted by x and t. Of course, I could have called e to the kappa x as some other coordinates, and then it would have gone back to our rho cos h of something and rho sin h of something. But when you do the radar coordinate, this is what comes up. Now, the main difference between this and the Lorentz transformation is that in the case of Lorentz transformation, you can explicitly verify, and I am sure you might have done it in the class, that if you take the line interval dt square minus dx square, that remains invariant. So, you take dt square minus dx square, and you transform is to small t and small x, and that will be dt square minus dx square in small variables. Here that is not the case, because if I take this dt square plus dx square, which you write as t minus x into t plus x d of that. Now, t minus x and t plus x we have written down here. So, if I take d of that, you will pick up a kappa which will cancel this, then you will have e to the this, and then you will again get dt minus dx. So, what you are going to get is the product of these two objects. And you will find that e to the minus kappa t and e to the plus kappa t will cancel out. But e to the plus kappa x and e to the plus kappa x will add up. As a result of which, you will get e to the 2 kappa x into minus dt square plus dx square. So, the inertial line interval minus dt square plus dx square goes into a different metric which is multiplied by this quantity. If you do 4 dimension, you assume the other two coordinate, nothing is happening. You are going on an accelerated trajectory along a given axis x. Because it is a uniform acceleration, we know that its direction does not change and its magnitude also does not change. And you rotate your coordinate system originally so that it is along x. So, any uniform acceleration you can always study in this form. So, there is no loss of generality involved there. So, what happens is that this part picks up by e to the kappa x and this part remains as it is. This is what you get. Now, I want to write down a couple of other forms of this which is going to be useful for us. The first thing is that in this, I can take e to the kappa x to be some x square, that is e to the kappa x is equal to some other x bar. Then what will happen is that these things will, this is going to just become dx square, because e to the x dx, e to the kappa x dx is my new variable. So that is going to be some x bar square. This is going to stay put. So you get this form, kappa x bar square dt square plus this quantity. This is what we started with. So, this is just like if you think of it as r, it is dr square and this is some r square and this is d theta square. Now, I am trying to make connections with what we saw before, so that since many of you may be seeing it for the first time. So, this metric, this form of the metric is same as this form of the metric. All that I have done is to assume e to the kappa x dx is dx bar. Okay? So, the moment I do that, this e to the kappa x here is going to be some integral of this. So, this is going to be essentially x bar square with a constant. But e to the kappa x dx is going to be my dx bar square, and that is how you end up getting dx bar square, dy square, dz square and this quantity left here. Okay? So, here if I think of kappa times t as some theta and I also do an analytic continuation, then what I have got here is some coordinate square times d of an angle square plus that d of that coordinate square. That is just polar coordinates in a plane and the rest of it goes for a ride. So, I hope that part is clear. This connects up with what we did earlier. So, that coordinate system, the reason I am doing all this is because in a Euclidean plane, if I use polar coordinates and I do analytically continue back to the Lorentzian plane, what does those coordinates mean? What I have shown is that those coordinates have an elementary physical significance, namely these are the natural coordinate system to be used by an accelerated observer. This is the point. There is one more coordinate you can introduce, which I have written down here, which is going to be extremely useful. And that is obtained by these transformations. So, first let me show you the transformation here itself. All that you need to do is to think of this quantity as 2 kappa psi. Rest will take care of itself. What is going to happen here is that there is a d psi square upon 2 kappa psi. Take it as d psi upon square root of psi. So, if I integrate that, you will get something. So, essentially that new coordinate x bar will be square root of psi. So, this square is going to become just this psi. So, from here to here, as I said, you can just by little bit of imagination, you can see this transformation. You just map this point to this point and this square will map to this. But when you do that, something very remarkable happens. To do that, let me go back to this original definition. Originally, we said kappa t is equal to kappa x and one is sin h and the other is cos h. And I had put here some coordinate. This coordinate could have been, think of kappa equals 1, that does not make any difference. So, think of this as x bar. Now, I just put x bar is equal to square root of 2 psi. So, if I put x bar is equal to square root of 2 psi, I can go from here to here. X bar is square root of 2 psi, so x bar square will be 2 psi. This comes out and this also will come out. So, I have this transformation, but now I can also have this psi going into negative values. But in the negative values, I can't put the square root. So, what I do is that I am just going to put a minus sign inside and say that I am going to work with this minus sign. Okay? And I could have further put extra minus signs here. Instead of doing anything, what I have done here is to flip sin h to cos h and cos h to sin h. This is important. What happens now is obvious if I look at the inverse transformation. Suppose I take x square minus t square. So, if I take x square minus t square, I have cos h square minus sin h square, which is 1, and the square of this will give me psi. So, I get x square minus t square equals psi. Let us do it here. Here I am going to do x square minus t square, that is sin h square minus cos h square, that is minus 1, and that is going to be minus psi. Therefore, again x square minus t square is going to be psi. This equation is universally true in both these transformations. But let us ask what this equation means. This equation tells you that if I look at psi is equal to constant lines, if I look at psi is equal to constant lines and I keep psi positive, then these are hyperbolas like this. This is x square minus t square equals psi greater than 0. Don't worry about factors of 2 and kappa. So, this is what we have. But if psi is negative, then these are hyperbolas here. So, this part of the world can be filled with the psi greater than 0. And this part of the world can be filled with psi less than 0. On the other hand, if I use this coordinate system, I can never go to this part of the world. And remember, this is your horizon. So, your psi sort of goes along the horizon. Psi is equal to 0 is your horizon. That is exactly what I said in this metric. And this has exactly the same form as like short sail metric. There is some function here, 1 by that function here. This is what we saw originally, okay? And I said there are hyperbolas. Those hyperbolas are obtained by psi is equal to constant. So, if I use psi coordinate, the psi is equal to constant guy is this hyperbola, and he is a uniformly accelerated observer. On the other hand, here psi is equal to constant, which I draw, is not a time-like curve. That is because of the flip in the sign here. When psi is negative, t is not a time coordinate. So, I can't interpret it in a very nice way there. This metric is still invariant under t going to t plus epsilon, but t is like a space-like coordinate. Okay? You have to just live with it. But I can introduce that coordinates here and here. All that I need to do is to flip this sin h to cos h here and cos h to sin h here. Most of the time, we will be studying the region here, so to speak, outside the horizon or outside the black hole horizon. Sometimes we may want to study what happens here and what happens when you make the transition. That is not at all clear in this coordinate system, the top coordinate system, but it is very clear here because psi can flip this one. Okay? So, this is an important point to remember. We will use both the coordinate system. In this coordinate system, it has the advantage that the periodicity in time is very apparent because it is like a polar coordinate. And all the intuition we have on a Euclidean polar coordinate can be brought in. This coordinate system, it is an advantage because you can cover both the inside of the horizon, so to speak, and the outside of the horizon. And this transformation takes care of all the factors at one go. So, keep that in mind. Fine. Yeah. Yes. That's correct. In fact, we when we did the radar coordinate, this is the metric we got. This does not cover the whole region. It only covers the right wedge, so to speak. So, we will talk in terms of wedges. So, if I have drawn these two lines, this is called the right wedge, this is the left wedge, this is called the future wedge, and this is the past wedge. It's just a nomenclature. Original coordinate system only covered the right wedge. But I could have taken care of this wedge as well by putting a minus sign. So x positive will go into x negative and t positive will go into t negative. I could have done that. So I can cover both this right wedge and the left wedge in terms of that original coordinate system with a minus sign, which I didn't write down, but you can take care of it. But there is no way you will take care of these two. On the other hand, this particular coordinate system, which we obtained by coordinate transformations, covers this and this. Okay? So I can at one go with that psi and tau, I can psi and t, I can cover both of them. I haven't changed the time coordinate. I only changed the spatial coordinate. And this is advantageous because if you want to connect it with something which is very close to the horizon of a black hole or horizon of something else, etc., this coordinate system is convenient. Near r is equal to 2m, this is the coordinate system you'll have if you take up r minus 2m as a coordinate. Okay? This is the form it will get. Fine. I agree it is a bit confusing, but we are going to do this in very many different ways, so by the end of it, you will be familiar with it. There is another very surprising thing which I want to mention, and this is also a bit of a cautionary note, because sometimes in some textbooks or in loose talking, people mix up two different concepts. When I said x square minus t square equals psi greater than 0 gives you a curve, you have to be a bit careful. The left hand side of this curve is invariant under x going to minus x and t going to minus t. So I could have also drawn a curve here. And similarly, this curve I could have reflected and drawn a curve here. Right? This is a problem in the way we are taught how to draw curves. Somebody at some stage has said that y is equal to f of x is a curve. Y is equal to f of x is not a good curve. A good curve is x is equal to x of lambda, y is equal to y of lambda, and you vary lambda. Okay? Then all these multiple choices, etc., will go away. So the way you should have talked about the curves is that one curve is given by, suppose you are looking in the Euclidean plane, one curve is given by not x square plus t square equals a square, which is a circle, but that is a bad way to think about a circle. The good way to think about a circle is a parametric form. T is x sin t and t is x cos t. Okay? Therefore, x is equal to constant, when you change this t, it just goes round and round in this circle. And you can vary this t from minus infinity to plus infinity. It just goes round and round. It is just one curve. Now you make an analytic continuation and it becomes x is equal to cos h and x is equal to sin h. It does not go to the left hand side. This is the point I am trying to stress. I am not talking about pairs of hyperbolas. I am talking about a single hyperbola. If I write it as x square minus t square equals something, it is not clear whether I am talking about a single hyperbola or I am talking about a pairs of hyperbola. Because you have to then take a square root of t square plus a square and I say I am taking positive sign. Okay? So this is symmetric under this, so it actually describes a pair of hyperbolas. While this equation describes a single hyperbola. When I change this t from minus infinity to plus infinity, you move along this blue curve, which is same as this blue curve which you rotate around. And in fact, interestingly, if you take kt is equal to minus pi and kt is equal to plus pi, you get these two lines. So you can put kt is equal to plus pi and minus pi. I mean, you can work it out in cos calculator. You'll get e to the pi minus e to the minus pi and e to the pi plus e to the minus pi. You'll get some numerical values. At that numerical values, this reddish region maps into the entire circle. Because the circle is only going from, let us say, minus pi to plus pi. So I've taken it as 0 to 2 pi, it doesn't matter. I'm taking it symmetrically. This angle, if it goes from minus pi, which is somewhere here, and then it goes around and goes to plus pi, that is same as going from this minus pi to this plus pi. And it is bounded by some tau is equal to constant line. So this particular region in Minkowski space fills this entire circle. And the trajectory of the accelerated particle between this point and this point has filled the one circle. What about all the trajectory which is remaining here, here, etc.? Well, it just goes round and round. Okay? So this is a very peculiar thing which happens when you go from Minkowski to the Euclidean. This is related to causal structure, etc., etc. But I want to sort of, you know, get you accustomed to these peculiar features. So this is, there is nothing hangy-pangy here. This is a simple property of this transformation which we have introduced. In this transformation, T can go all the way from minus infinity plus infinity. And in this also, T can go from all the way from minus infinity plus infinity, but it is a periodic function. So it just goes around in the circle. This also means that if you can sort of control what is happening between these two, and if the Euclidean plane knows everything and that is going to give you what is happening in the physics, then you know all the physics is contained somewhere here, and that is replaced in that. That we will use at many, many, many different cases. This is also related to the fact I told you that sometimes people worry that this uniformly accelerated observer, if he has been accelerating all the way from time immemorial, then it is a hyperbola. But if he decided to stop accelerating, or if he started accelerating here and then went on to this, then this is not the picture. But it really doesn't matter as long as he is accelerating within this sector, because the Euclidean thing is done. And the rest of the curves may not be so relevant. So there is a natural time scale, which is 1 over kappa, which comes up in the physics. So if the acceleration sort of remains constant for a time scale, which is of the order of 1 over that acceleration, then most of the conclusions which we are talking about will hold. You don't have to have an eternally accelerating observer. Sometimes people claim that, oh, this is all defined for an eternally accelerating observer. Can we use it for a finite acceleration? Actually, you can. There will be corrections, but these are controllable corrections. The other peculiar thing is that, this I have told you yesterday, but let me emphasize it again. These two lines corresponds to x square minus t square equals 0. It is x is equal to plus t and x is equal to minus t. If I analytically continue, it becomes x square plus t square equals 0. And because I am using real te and real x, the only solution to this is x is equal to 0, te equal to 0. So the two light cones sort of merge into this point. Okay? The light cones disappear. This is, we discussed quite a bit yesterday, and we will probably be discussing again and again in later classes. But the light cones disappear in the Euclidean plane. But in return for that, the Euclidean plane gifts you with something else. If I had this coordinate transformation, there is no way I can figure out what is going on here. This coordinate system do not cover negative x. But if I just make an analytic continuation, it covers negative x, because cosine can become negative, cos h can never become negative. So this trajectory never visits negative x's. But the same trajectory in the Euclidean plane goes to the negative axis. So you will find that this is extremely important, that the information about what is going on behind the horizon is hidden in the imaginary values of time when t goes to t plus I pi. T plus 2i pi is a periodicity. It will come back to the same thing. But t plus I pi will just flip the sign. X will go to minus x, and the t plus I pi in the imaginary thing here is, this is just going by a value pi. So when you go by a value pi in this angle, you just go from here to here, x becomes minus x. So what is behind the horizon is captured in the Euclidean coordinate system, and that is why you can do Euclidean physics and get away with it. But this particular guy here, he has to do a little bit more work in order to take into account that something here is not visible to him. Okay, all this will come along as we go. Okay, yeah.
So I'm just trying to understand this mapping between the vertical region.
Right.
You're saying t is plus or minus
pi. That's correct.
But then,
so take
will have an I.
Oh, that doesn't matter. That goes away because there was I here and here. So first let us take a look at this. The mapping is that you have a x sin h of t and x cos h of t. Now I'm going to change, I'm going to put I t equals Euclidean. So the sin h will pick up an I, but there is an I in this as well. That cancel out. So this goes into this, and this goes into this. But the miraculous thing is that these functions are periodic, these functions are not. It's a fact of life. So as a result of which, if my t goes to I t, now suppose t goes from, let us say, minus pi to plus pi, then I t will go from minus I pi to plus I pi. And the tau will go from just pi to minus pi, because that I has been removed. When it does that, you are going in that imaginary coordinate system from, let us say, from this place to this place and you have covered the full circle. Then if you go a little bit further, so just take this and give KTE a value which is greater than 2 pi. Then it is equivalent to another value which is less than 2 pi. Now take that KTE value and analytically continue back. That is not going to give you back a value which is less than 2 pi because it's not a periodic function. So a point here gets mapped back to a point somewhere here when you do this. That is, or rather, a point here gets identified with a point here in this circle. That is what is going on. Okay? So it is peculiar, but it is important and is going to, this is the root cause of it, because it is periodic in imaginary time, and that is where your thermal feature comes up and all that. And the Euclidean plane knows it. And when you do the maths right, it pops out of it. Okay? Yeah. Fine. Yeah. Yeah. Red line. Yeah, the 45 degree lines. Yeah. Yeah. No, inertial observers don't have a horizon. No, no, inertial, if it is an inertial observer, he just runs through every horizon. What you mean is that the accelerated observer in the Minkowski frame has this as the horizon. That is the correct statement. An inertial observer is a vertical line. He covers everything. Yeah, right. Yeah. Yes. Right. Right. No. If you do weak rotation and you use Cartesian coordinate, nothing will go wrong. That is why quantum field theory and standard model and everything works. Okay? That is Lorentz invariance. If you do weak rotation in polar coordinates, you have to be very careful. That is the difference. The weak rotation between Tx Cartesian coordinates in Minkowski to Tex Cartesian coordinates in Euclidean is perfect. No surprises, nothing peculiar. But now what you do is that you first go to the Euclidean weak rotated T and X, and then I say I want to, this is a plain sheet of paper, I want to use polar coordinates. Then you do a weak rotation in that weird time coordinate, which is actually an angle. And you take a weak rotation back, then you will get all these features. Okay? So, yeah, honest to God, quantum field theory in flat space-time guy could have even said that you can only use Cartesian coordinate. But we don't want to do that, because in a curved geometry, we don't know what coordinates we are talking about. That is the problem. Yeah. Okay. So now, yeah. Right. That's right. Well, let us not worry about understanding the part. What I am saying is that it accesses negative values of x. See, this particular function, we are always going to keep capital X as positive. So in this function, when t goes to any value you like, is never going to be negative because cos h is never negative. The corresponding analytically continued function, again I am keeping x positive, so I am not cheating, but when I change t beyond some pi, this function can become negative. So minus x can be covered by this transformation, minus x cannot be covered by this transformation. That is what happened. Okay. Now let us start getting a bit further and getting towards Planck spectrum kind of a thing. So what I want to do is a very elementary exercise. Suppose I have a plane wave. So the plane wave is a function of t and x. Let us do 1 plus 1. And it is exponential minus omega t minus x. So this is a positive frequency wave. So just one word, I mean, whenever it is e to the minus I omega t, we call it positive frequency. I mean, this is not one of the quirks of relativity. This has a motivation because I h bra, when you write down Schrodinger equation, you have a I h cross d by dt, which is the Hamiltonian or the energy. So I h cross d by dt acting on this will give you a positive energy if there is a negative sign on top. So this is indeed a positive frequency object with omega being positive. So at a given point x, it is varying with time like e to the minus I omega t. So the inertial guy will say I have a monochromatic wave with a frequency omega. Now we want to see how this is perceived by other observers. So in particular, let us say that there is a guy who is moving with a uniform velocity. So we know what is t and x by Lorentz transformation. So you plug it in. So your t minus x will change into his proper time tau gamma into 1 minus v. Elementary, I mean that t minus x is, we in fact showed it, t minus x goes into this factor, that factor is what we wrote as 1 minus v upon 1 plus v. T minus x is u, u and v get contracted and elongated under Lorentz transformation. So you find that this phi evaluated along the trajectory, that is for this t and x, I plug in t of tau and x of tau and then I get a functional form in terms of tau. This has a very simple physical meaning, that is what you should capture in mind, that what we are having here is that you have some plane wave in the tx coordinate system. This is x, this is t, all over this place there is a plane wave which is going there and there is an observer who is moving with a uniform velocity. So he has a clock that is measuring the time coordinate tau along this curve. So there is a plane wave here, plane wave here, plane wave here, plane wave here, and he is asking how it is varying along his trajectory. This I can do for any observer. Right now I am just sticking to a uniform velocity observer. So you find that this is what it is. So he will say, great, this was a monochromatic wave because it was varying with a given frequency. I again see a monochromatic wave changing with respect to my wristwatch time. But the frequency has changed, that we know, that is called Doppler effect. So all that we have seen is a Doppler shift derived it in a particular way. But then I can do this with another trajectory. You can take some crazy trajectory and ask how it looks like. In particular, I can take a uniformly accelerated observer. So I will set that constant here to be just some value. So he is at a psi is equal to some constant and I have taken it to be 1 by kappa. So you have x of tau which is 1 by kappa cos h of k tau and t of tau 1 by kappa sin h of t. So if in fact x square minus t square is going to be 1 by kappa square. So this is a hyperbola in this space time with a distance determined by 1 by kappa square. So let us play the same game. So you find x of t of tau and you substitute for this and substitute for this and you know how it is varying with tau. So now what you are going to do is that you are essentially computing t minus x multiplying by omega. T minus x is going to be sin h minus cos h, that is going to give you an exponential minus k tau multiplied by omega. So I can write this as e to the I some function theta of tau. So the instantaneous frequency will be the derivative of this function. So this instantaneous frequency is omega by kappa, this quantity. Derivative of that with respect to tau with a minus sign because we are looking at e to the minus I omega tau kind of e to the minus I omega t kind of transformation for the waves. So when you take a derivative of this, this kappa and this kappa will cancel and you get omega exponential minus k tau. This is one thing which you should commit to memory because we are going to meet it at least 6-7 times during the lecture course in the next few lectures. What this means is that the frequency is exponentially redshifted. So you have a plane wave and there is a guy who is accelerating through that plane wave and he sees this wave not as a monochromatic wave but as a frequency shifted wave and the frequency shifting is time dependent. So it's a kind of a time dependent frequency here. And if you want to define an instantaneous frequency by the derivative of the phase, that frequency is getting exponentially redshifted. For a very large tau, it is going to come down quite a bit. Okay, what will he interpret this as? So if you give a signal like this to an engineer, he will say, oh, let me look at its power spectrum. There is some crazy signal going on. What is its power spectrum? So you can compute its power spectrum. So to get the power spectrum, you take this function and you think of it in Fourier space, some f of nu e to the minus I nu tau. Of course, engineers will never integrate from minus infinity to plus infinity. They are sensible people who knows that the frequency is positive. But here we are just doing a mathematical Fourier transform. So nu is going from minus infinity to plus infinity. So we are just doing a Fourier transform the entire range. I could have written it down as 0 to infinity some a f nu and then minus infinity plus infinity some b f nu. But what was just a positive frequency wave here with a constant omega is going to be, this Fourier transform is going to have support both positive nu and negative nu. How do you find f of nu? You take that f phi f tau, which is an exponential, phi f tau is exponential of an exponential function. And you do a Fourier transform of that. This is one integral which again we will meet 7 times in different cases, okay. But this integral can be done. I'll probably show it to you the details just for the heck of it, but after that, hereafter I will just write down the value. So you can take this, you can evaluate this Fourier transform and you will find that f of nu is given not by not such a complicated function, it is a gamma function and times this object. What is interesting is that if you take the power spectrum of this f nu square and evaluate it for negative frequencies, so you have a positive frequency wave, you want to know how much of it has spilled into the negative frequency regime, okay. We have back of mind things like alphas and betas. So if I had an alpha which was some creation and annihilation operator and I am doing a Bogolyubov transformation, then the positive frequency to negative frequency mixing is given by that beta, and I know that mod beta square is going to give me the number density, so it would be nice to see how much is that quantity. This is there in the back of my mind, but here we are doing a plain simple classical calculation. You can compute this mod square of this, this will go away, this will just give you 2, but you need to know what is gamma of ix mod square, just check up your gamma function thing, that can be computed, it is some pi upon x into sin h of pi x. So it is a known function, and then when you put all of them into account, you will get this form. The essential point is it depends on nu is Planckian. It is e to the beta nu minus 1, and that beta will be 2 pi over cup. So this is your first hint that there is a thermal spectrum hanging around. But this calculation is entirely classical, there is no H cross anywhere. So this is the frequency nu and this beta will come out as an inverse of kappa, and if you actually look at it, kappa is an acceleration. C square divided by kappa has a length dimension, and that divided by C by G will have dimensions of time, and then inverse of that will be a frequency. So this is just a nu divided by some nu naught. But I can put a H on top and H at the bottom, then I will get a temperature which is H dependent. That is how I wrote down that formula, H cross over C into G over 2 pi is the temperature, okay. Now let us see what we have done. What we have done is the most elementary derivation of the thermal spectrum. All we did was to take a plane wave and then say that let us see how this plane wave will be pursued by an accelerated observer. And then we computed its power spectrum, and then we looked at the power spectrum in negative frequencies. So the crucial sort of insight from quantum field theory inputs into this are two. First, we took a complex wave. This came from e to the minus I omega t minus x. What happens if I take a real wave? Suppose I take cosine of omega t minus x, the waves which we are familiar with. Suppose there is an actual electromagnetic wave going through it and somebody is accelerating. The result is incredible, and this is an open project for anyone who is interested in doing. We have worked it out and it gives you something remarkable. When you do the same calculation, you get the answer that power spectrum of whatever turns out to be proportional to n plus half plus square root of n into n plus 1 times cosine of some parameter which depends on all kinds of parameters in the problem. This is what you get. This n is number of particles in a thermal spectrum which I have written down here, 1 over e to the beta nu minus 1, okay. N plus half can be thought of as the number plus a 0 point contribution. So because if I multiply it by h cross omega, this is what the photons are contributing, this is what the 0 point is contributing. Then you get a completely surprising term, square root of n into n plus 1. Now, those of you who have actually studied Planck spectrum properly, if you think of Planck spectrum as the mean number of seromass bosons in thermal equilibrium, you can also calculate the mean square fluctuations. If you compute the mean square fluctuations, you will find that it is actually n into n plus 1. There is an n square part and an n part. N square part, one part comes from the particle nature of the photons and the other part comes from the wave nature of the photons, and they add Pythagoreanly and you do get this. So, not only you get this thing with a zero pointer, you also get a root n plus n. We do not know what is the physical meaning of this, and this is something which is worth looking at. But as far as our purpose is concerned, this is not very relevant, because what we want is complex waves. Because in quantum field theory, what we have got is the complex waves going as e to the minus I omega t and e to the plus I omega t. So, that is fine, that is what we have done. Yes? You will get this. Something like that. Yeah, I can give you a reference to a paper which we wrote in which this is worked out. Yeah. That is what I am coming to. Just a minute. Okay. So, there are two quantum inputs I set which has gone in. The first quantum input is we cheated by taking a complex wave rather than a real wave, because you know ultimately we want complex waves. The second thing which we did was we computed it at minus nu. Now, I could have done it slightly differently. I was just lazy to take it in. I could have written down this phi of tau as 0 to infinity a nu e to the minus I nu t plus b nu e to the plus I nu t, right? Then I could have calculated what is a nu square and what is b nu square. You will find that one of them comes b nu square, the cross term where positive to negative comes up with 1 upon e to the beta nu minus 1. And the other term comes up with a e to the beta nu on top. So, you will get both these terms in the both positive sector and negative sector, and they will be the alpha square and beta square in a Bogoliubov transformation. And remember, alpha square minus beta square has to be 1. So, if beta square is this, you can compute the alpha square, it is 1 plus this quantity. When you do 1 plus this 1 over e to the beta nu minus 1, it is just going to give you an eta beta nu on the top. That is what you will get. Does it answer your question, or you were asking something else? How am I? Well, I mean, it is just a Fourier transform of a signal, and there is no h cross anywhere inside. It is in frequency space. It is nu divided by a nu naught. So I just need a characteristic frequency in the problem. Kappa divided by c square and kappa divided by c. They gives me the characteristic frequency. And in fact, this is true even when you do a quantum mechanical calculation. What you finally get in frequency space is 1 upon e to the nu divided by some characteristic frequency. The quantum mechanics comes in due to dear old Max Planck. Instead of writing it as nu by nu naught, you write h nu upon h nu naught, and you call h nu naught as kT. Okay? So, there absolutely there is no cheating. This is exactly what will happen when you do Hawking radiation from a black hole. You will only get a frequency divided by the characteristic frequency. But we interpret this frequency as energy. In order to do that, you have to multiply by a h. That is the standard quantum mechanics. Okay, that is what we are doing here also. Fine. This is a good place to stop, and let me take questions and then we will go further. Oh, one second. Let me just finish off the maths on that, because I don't want to come back to this. Okay. I told you that this is the integral which we want to do, and let me, because I don't want to repeatedly do this, so let me get it out of the way. So, this is exponential of an exponential which is the wave, and you are doing a Fourier transform with respect to some variable u. What you do is that you have this exponential of this object, this e to the minus kappa u, you call some x or something, then you have e to the I omega by kappa times x, then this rest of it, because you have taken e to the some u as some x, this whole thing become x to the power this quantity. So, this is like x to the n minus 1 e to the x dx. So, it is like a gamma function, not quite, because you have all the imaginary objects hanging around. So, you start with a honest to God integral x to the power s minus 1 e to the minus bx is essentially b to the minus s, which you write at exponential minus log b times gamma of s. This is standard and rigorous. Now, what you do is that this log b here, you have to pick up this log b. This b is coming from somewhere here, and that is going to be log And in order for convergence, you again need an I epsilon, you put that in and then take the limit of epsilon going to 0. When you do that, you just work it out, this comes from some tan inverse of infinity and you get minus I times the sine of omega by kappa. So, in general, later on we will be doing it for both omega negative and positive. If omega is positive, then you do not have to worry about it, this is just plus 1, otherwise this is the result which you get, okay. It also has the identity that for omega and minus omega, they are related by an exponential factor. So, this is a result which we will repeatedly be using, that is whenever there is a, what I will do hereafter is that I will show in some particular context there is a exponential redshift. Then I will say, okay, now go and do your integrals and you are going to get a Planck spectrum. Exponential redshifts map to the Planck spectrum when you do this integral and take the powers magnitude. That is, there is a beta square which is thermal, which comes out of that. So, this is the only place where I am working out the details, or rather showing you the details, yeah, okay, questions, yeah, sorry, well, we are trying to do classical physics, so there is no concept of bosonic or fermionic distribution, it just turns out that it is equal to this quantity. In fact, it is completely mysterious why an exponential waveform, exponentially redshifted waveforms, power spectrum is Planckian. It's just a mathematical result at this stage. Okay, you can actually do that. That you take a signal generator, and you generate a signal whose actual time domain behavior is exponential redshift. And then you take a characteristic time scale and you integrate, I mean you can't wait up to infinity and you do a Fourier transform and you will find a Planckian curve. Yeah. You will get completely different kind of spectrum. So, the original result which I showed you is extremely general in the sense that I could have taken any other, it is here, yeah. See, what I did was to take this phi, plane wave, plugged in t of tau and x of tau, then I get something, right? Now, I could have taken a trajectory which is, let us say, cos h of kappa tau square and sin h of kappa tau square, then I would have got exponential kappa tau square. Then the Fourier transform will be something completely different and you will end up getting something else. What is remarkable is that near every horizon which we are going to meet, there will be exponential redshift. So, that is why there is a bit of a universality which comes in. Right, this is a particular accelerated observer. If I take some other observer who is going on some weird quantity, then this t of tau and x of tau will be something else and then you can plug that in and you can do the integral.
Maybe just in Schwarzschild-related
black hole,
r equals constant is a nice observer.
It is slightly more than that. In all the horizons which we know of, which comes from a bifurcate killing horizon, the so-called nice observers, as you call them, will have a hyperbolic trajectory. Because of it, they will have a sin h and cos h. So, all of them see a bit of a universality there.
There is no reason to not think about other observers who have more complicated.
Absolutely. For example, if you take a black hole space-time and you take a freely falling observer, what you get is completely different. This is why I am saying the temperature of a black hole is observer dependent. It is this hyperbolic observer who is seeing the temperature. If a guy is plunging into the black hole, he will see something completely different. And that is, yeah, it's a good point to bring up. Itself doesn't exist. The thermal spectrum arises only for this kind of observer. So, saying that there is a horizon and you know, the because of which it is come, etc., it is all intricately woven into this concept. See, this particular transformation gives you exponential redshift. Exponential redshift gives you thermal spectrum, therefore there is a temperature. On the other hand, this transformation also has periodicity in imaginary time. And we know that if a system has periodicity in imaginary time, there is a temperature associated with it. So, it is all internally consistent in a very beautiful way. But I can complicate the matter and think of other observers and then it will not be thermal. Yeah, yeah. Any other?
Of minus 2.
Yes. What is happening here is that in the back of the mind, I have the calculation which I showed you first, where you have a e to the minus ipx and b e to the and a dagger e to the ipx, and then I did an alpha and beta. What alpha and beta did was to mix up negative and positive frequencies, and I want to pick up the beta part of it. Why do I want to pick up the beta part? Because in the in one of the vacuum, the number of particles of the other kind is mod beta square. So I want to pick up the beta part. So, if I want to pick up the beta part, I want the mixing between positive and negative frequency. So, I started with a positive frequency and asked how much of its power is spilling into the negative frequency. It is motivated by that quantum consideration, but I could have done this complete. This calculation could have been done probably by Newton. He knew about waves, he knew about Fourier transforms, he invented calculus. So it is a, he probably could have integrated this and computed it. Yeah. No. Okay. Hold on. Actually, you do expect negative frequency. Suppose you take an arbitrary function in time, and you do a Fourier transform. It will definitely will have support in the negative frequency domain. You need a very special condition so that the negative frequencies are zero. Okay, but what engineers usually do is to either work with signals where you first define it in the frequency domain and then do a Fourier transform, then it is fine, or they think of A and B and then take two of them. This is, again, as I said, this is sheer mathematics in the sense that if you take an arbitrary f of t and do a Fourier transform, it will have support on negative in you. You can't get away with it. Yeah. Yeah. There are two of you. So it, no, actually Planck spectra is not quantum in nature. For example, if a radio astronomer is detecting Planck spectra, he will not count photons. An X-ray observer will count photons.
That is because they use the Rayleigh gene approximation.
No, even without Rayleigh gene approximation, I can say that it is in the frequency domain. It is a question of whether you are talking about energy domain or frequency domain. In the frequency domain, the Planck spectrum is completely classical. Because h nu upon some quantity, you take that h away, then it is nu divided by nu naught. That is what is happening here. Then if you put a h nu and say h nu is the energy of a quanta, then you are talking in terms of number of particles. So if you think of photons as built out of, I mean, electromagnetic radiation to be built out of photons, which are discrete quantities, or electromagnetic radiation is built out of waves, which are continuous quantities, is the difference between a frequency domain observation and a discrete number domain observation or energy domain observation. So there is nothing surprising there. That is what I am trying to tell you. The H cross in Planck spectrum can be taken off in terms of a critical frequency. If you do black hole evaporation and you do the computation, if you work in frequencies, then you will find e to the some frequency divided by a critical frequency. But that is what you are putting in my hand. Maths doesn't know about that. Okay? Yeah. Anything else? Yeah.
What is the positive
frequency? You get multiplied by e to the beta nu. See, the positive frequency is going to give you mod alpha square. Negative frequency is giving mod beta square. Mod alpha square is 1 plus mod beta square. The point here is that the wave is always t minus x. Its dependence is t minus x. I just did a Fourier transform. So t minus x, whatever going it is, that is going to remain the same. Yeah. No, I never use Euclidean time here. Never. Oh, don't think of tau as Euclidean time. This is just the proper time of the accelerating observer. It's completely in physical time. This is also physical time. Here also I use tau. Tau is the proper time of the observer. See, there are only finite number of Greek letters. So, you know, I can't choose one for every one of them. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that is what seems to come out of this. Because square root of n into n plus 1 is a photon statistic. I have no clue how it emerges out of it. Again, it comes out of mathematics. That is very strange, but we don't have an explanation for it. The only other person who has sort of derived it in a different context is somebody called Gerlach, and he also doesn't have an explanation for it. Or rather, he has some kind of an explanation, but not exactly. Yeah. Any other comments? Yeah. Yeah. That's right. No, we didn't. What we have, now I'll tell you what we have done. I mean, if at all there is something clever Bondi has done, what he has said is that you should define all coordinates and all times using light alone. Okay? So, it is the light rays which was used to define the coordinates of a point. So, what I am saying is that if I want to know the coordinates of that point, I am sitting here. What I do is that I shine a beam of light there, and there is a mirror there which is reflecting back. So, I measured when the light was emitted and when the light came back. Okay? If I am moving, so be it. As long as I am moving uniform in velocity, I just arrange things in such a way that it comes back to me. Then I take the time difference and I say that I know the time of flight, that divided by half is the distance, and I know the half of that average of the time is the time coordinate. This gives back Lorentz transformation. We did not assume that ds square is invariant in this computation at all. Yes. But the... That is correct. The fact that it is a boost comes as a result. I didn't put it in because I did not even know what is Lorentz transformation when I started. Okay? Yeah. Right. These are just two inertial coordinates. Then somebody is moving in that direction. That's all. So in that is absolutely correct, but that is a result, not an input. No, we have not. In fact, that is why I keep saying in other classes when I teach special relativity, etc., this is the correct way to derive Lorentz transformation. Because, see, you say that t prime is gamma into t minus x and x prime is gamma into t, you know, x minus vt. How do I know that a guy who is moving with a uniform, in a uniform velocity car is going to use these coordinates? We always say that a guy who is moving with a uniform velocity uses these coordinates compared to the other coordinates. How do I know? One way of knowing it is that if that guy who is moving in the car is going to set up a coordinate system using just light rays, this is a natural way to do it. But the general covariance of the physics, which is even applicable in special relativity, in classical special relativity, tells you that he could have used some other coordinate system and physics would take care of it. Any other question? That is tomorrow's. Right.
After this step, you just calculate the power spectrum.
I did a Fourier transform.
So, what does that mean?
No, it is just power spectrum. You said it. I mean, you have a signal and I compute its power spectrum. The signal is changing with time in a particular form, and I am just asking what is the power spectrum of that signal.
Okay.
No, there is, I am only computing the power spectrum. So, once I have done power spectrum, all the time information is gone. Right? It is a frequency domain information. Okay, we'll meet tomorrow.